Well, happy Thursday, everybody. Welcome, everyone, to Saki Speakeasy Podcast. I'm your host, Saki Speaks, and I appreciate you giving me a bit of your most precious commodity, your time. Y'all, please show my moderator, Love Jones, some love and affection, moving in the right direction. And please make sure that you like the video on your way in. Drop in the chat box and say, hey, girl, hey. All right. And if you haven't already, which again, I'm not sure why you haven't already, please subscribe to the channel, making sure to click the notification bell and select all so you don't miss out on an opportunity to chill with us when the Speakeasy is open for business. Now, with that being said, welcome to all of my new sippers and speakers. Thank you so much for subscribing to the channel. I hope you find a reason to stick around. And welcome back to my returning sippers and speakers and those of you catching this on the replay. Thank y'all for coming back one more again to love up on your girl, because y'all know I love the way that y'all love on me. All right, so listen, y'all. I'm nosy as shit. And I just really wanted to know how Ethic fared after the death of Raven. So I was like, shit, Saki, just go ahead on and read the next book. At least read the first one, right? Just, you know, continuity of content, right? So I figured I would come out here and give y'all a little bit of this one and then finish it up tomorrow. And then, you know, double back to the Rose books, because I gotta wait for Ethic 2 to come in the mail, y'all. It's not available anywhere online. It's paperback only, and I can't seem to find it. So I don't know what else to do other than wait. So we will reminisce with the Falling for a Rose series, or I should say we'll resume, right? We'll resume with the Falling for a Rose series after this one to allow time for that second book to arrive via snail mail, right? Because it's like, whatever. All right, so anyway, let's get this thing popping, all right? Let me see who's here. Hey, Love Jones, moderator extraordinaire. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Hey, Barb Meets World. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. Happy Thursday to you. Oh, this is one of your favorites? All right, but y'all, we're going to see what it's giving, because I've never read it before, but everybody is saying that I'm going to like it. So we'll see, y'all. Listen, that Moth to a Flame had me pissed off. Oh, my God, Barb, that Moth to a Flame, child. Listen, I was annoyed. Oh, my God. All right, so let me get my time stamp for the first portion here, and then we can get it going. Because, listen, if this one pissed me off, we ain't got to worry about book two. Okay? No. All right, so this is Ethic. And the synopsis reads, Ethic has power, but love has always been evasive. After ordering the hit that mistakenly killed the love of his life, Ethic is haunted with guilt, and he refuses to love again. Focused on being a better man and keeping his family safe, he's raising three children, one of which is a defiant teenaged girl, Morgan. No matter how hard he tries to keep Morgan away from the streets, she's determined to defy him. When Morgan finds herself in a vulnerable position, Ethic is pulled back into the deadly game where he was once king. In this explosive spinoff to Ashley Antoinette's Moth to a Flame, you'll fall in love with Ezra Okafor, aka Ethic, as he gambles on love and in the streets in hopes that this time he will win. Listen. Y'all hope this book don't piss me off, because I don't want to be talking cash money shit about a little deaf girl. So the baby's deaf. She can't hear. Like, how do you get in trouble and you're deaf? I would think that you would be able to trust no fucking body because you're deaf, right? You can't even hear the chaos coming. So I would think that you would be, anyway, let me be quiet. Just hush, Saki, and the goddamn book. Okay? All right, so let me get my time stamp so we can get into this thing, because just please don't piss me off. All right. All right, so I got my time stamp here, so let's get into it. Chapter 1. The sound of crickets serenaded the cemetery as Ethic sat on the white blanket, his knees up, his arms wrapped around him as he clasped his wrist with one hand while digging his heels into the ground. He watched his two children read as they leaned against her headstone. "I am a little black king. I can do any." His son Ezra paused as he looked up at Ethic. "Dad, what's this word?" he asked as he turned the book towards Ethic. "Anything," Ethic confirmed. "Try the sentence again." "I am a little black king. I can do anything," his son read. "Good job, Easy," Bella coached, affectionately calling him by his nickname as she looked up from her Harry Potter book. "Keep reading," Ethic urged. "Your mom wants to hear you finish the entire thing." It was their thing. It was how they stayed connected to the beautiful Raven Atkins. Although Raven wasn't Bella's mother, Bella was used to the routine. Her own mother had died when she was just a baby, and Ethic had started the practice with her. On the first of every month, they went to the cemetery and visited both graves, taking a blanket, a basket of food, and books in tow. It was how they stayed close to one another and to those they had lost. It was always a hard day for Ethic, but it made it easier for his kids, so he did it faithfully, never missing this time with them. Ethic was a cursed man, falling in love with two women and losing them both tragically. It seemed that death followed him wherever he went. Ethic had been so guarded and secluded since Raven's passing. He'd tried to find someone to fill the void. Only one woman had piqued his interest over the years, and he had met her by chance. Desiah Morgan. She had been a great distraction from the pain, but she hadn't been fully available to love him. She had a situation of her own that she couldn't abandon, thus leaving him alone to mourn a ghost that no one could compare to. The sun began to set, illuminating the cemetery in an orange hue, letting him know their day was coming to an end. "Let's pack up," Ethic said as he watched his children climb to their feet. "Put everything in the car. I'll be there soon," he told them. He watched them walk toward his Range Rover that sat a few yards away, and then he knelt in front of Raven's headstone. "I miss the shit out of you, Ray. Every day, every moment. You're a hard act to follow, Mom." He placed the bouquet of flowers he held directly in front of her headstone. Kissing his fingers, he placed them to her name. "Until next time, love, rest up." He blinked away his emotion and swiped his hands over his face. When he stood, all traces of vulnerability were erased from his expression. He never exposed his melancholy to his children. He stuffed his hands in the pockets of his hoodie as he headed back to his car. They drove through the city, a place he both loved and hated. Flint, Michigan was home. Within the perimeter of the city, Ethic was the crowned king. It wasn't a title he boasted proudly. He didn't particularly like the reputation at all. Claims like that are what led to the downfall of a lot of men before him, so he let the hood whisper without ever verifying anything. His younger years of mobbing through the city as Benny Atkins' lieutenant had earned him a reputation. No one knew that he was actually Benny's connect. He made the streets freeze with the snow he brought to town, but that was a long time ago. He never liked the limelight that came with the game. He preferred to get money quietly, which is why he allowed people to think that Benny Atkins had been the man on top. Even now, when he was trying to walk a straight line and keep his hands clean, his exit from the game was never acknowledged. He had turned in his walking papers, but still the game wouldn't leave him alone. His breed of hustler was rare, and the young ones admired him, often doing whatever it took just to be in Ethic's good graces. Ethic disguised the wealth he made in a distribution trucking company, several automotive repair shops, and other real estate investments throughout the Midwest, but he hadn't been able to truly rid himself of the reputation he had rightfully earned. At 34 years old, his priorities had changed, and the risks that came with the lifestyle were no longer worth it to him. As Ethic's strong hand gripped the expensive leather of his Range Rover, he studied the streets he used to rule. They had changed over the years. Businesses had tanked, causing the former gold mine to become a ghost town where there was no code of conduct. The rules had evolved, and the players had revolved to what was now an all-out war zone. Flint wasn't the same, and he did 80 miles per hour to get his children out of the city limits and back to the suburbs where he could keep them safe. Flint was where the lawless reigned. He wanted his children to know nothing of that part of his life. He peered into his back seat as Bella read her book and Easy transitioned to his handheld video game. His children didn't have a care in the world. They were his reasons for flying straight, and the smiles on their faces reminded him that they were the only constants that mattered. He tucked his turmoil away as if it was an old piece of clothing that he could put in the back of his closet and forget about. He couldn't dwell on his feelings. That was what women did. Sulking about what he couldn't have wouldn't do anything but keep him stagnant. As he pulled into the driveway to his home, he noticed the C-class Benz that was parked curbside. He sighed as he threw his Range Rover in park. He almost didn't want to get out. He didn't have the energy to put up the charade with the beautiful woman waiting faithfully for him in her car. She was always there, waiting, hoping that he would choose her. And although they had been on and off for years, he never settled down. She was never his pick. Dolce was just someone warm to lay next to, sometimes on the cold Michigan nights. As he processed the empty feeling that weighed on him, he couldn't help but feel a bit of guilt over the way he handled her. Do I give her this feeling? Is her loneliness caused by me? He thought. What torture the world would be if hurt was just one big cycle. Were men and women going around loving the ones they could never have and neglecting the ones right in front of them? Damn, Ethic thought. His mind was complex. The smallest notion could leave him reeling as he dissected the possibilities of its merit. Love was one of those puzzles that left him exhausted and frustrated. He just could not solve it. Hey, you, Dolce said as she stepped out of his car. No, I guess as he stepped out of his car. Shall I listen? Ethic took his time replying. He took his time doing everything. The world seemed to wait with bated breath as it anticipated his next move. He paused because he knew it would be easy to deflect what he was going through onto her. Her unannounced visit had thrown him. Her unrequested presence annoyed him, but he had to ask himself if the slim, leggy woman with an inviting smile and wanting eyes would have irritated him if he hadn't just come back from visiting the gravesite of the love of his life. Okay, wait, pause. Now, for those of you that were here for the reading of Moth to a Flame, when Raymond was in the hospital after the car accident and Dolce brought the children to the hospital, didn't she call him ugly and tell him that the only reason she was with him was because she had money, because he had money? So why the fuck is he still fucking around with her? That's a character flaw for me. I don't know. You better explain this shit, Ethic, because the way I'm looking at it, you seeming a little blimey right now. Why would you be fooling with somebody that told you that you was ugly? And anyway, whatever. Let me keep going, child. Oh, hey, Kim Cash. Good afternoon, darling. Thank you so much for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. All right. I wasn't expecting you, he said, his tone even, as he opened the back door of his car. Bella bounced out. Hey, Dolce, she greeted before running across the massive lawn to Ethic's home, heading for the front door. He reached down to grab Easy, who was dead weight in his strong arms. I thought you would need a good meal and some good company, Dolce said, as she held up the single plastic grocery bag she carried. Ethic wondered why he found it hard to take her seriously. I mean, she was a decent woman who offered something convenient. It may not be everything he required in a woman, but at least she was there. At least she put him above all else. When she bit into her bottom lip and added, and I need some good, she let her words linger, and it wasn't hard to fill in the blanks. He sighed as he remembered why she just didn't do it for him. She was too available, too easy, too much like a replica of every woman he crossed paths with these days. Her weave was long, her waist was unrealistically shaped, her ass too fat. Her brain too empty, he thought. He would rather appreciate the value in a dinged up quarter than accept a shiny penny. Dolce was shining, but her worth was insignificant. Well, damn, that's cold. All right. He took the plastic bag from her hand, holding his heavy child with one strong arm and the groceries in the other. Despite his lack of enthusiasm regarding her presence, he was still a gentleman. Are y'all hearing me? Am I sounding low or no? I don't know. I think I'm sounding low. I don't know if I'm sounding low or not. Y'all put a one in the chat if my sound is okay. I may be too far back from the microphone. I just want to make sure y'all can hear me. Somebody put a one. I know all y'all are busy, but I just want to make sure y'all can hear me. Okay. All right, Love Jones, thank you. There were no thrills in causing her embarrassment. He nodded his head toward the house. I'm a little tired, but dinner I can do, he said. Just the mere thought of being in his space, under his roof, at his dinner table, put a hope in her eyes that Epic hated because he knew he would never give her the more she sought. He walked into his home, eager to see the face of his oldest child, Morgan. She looked so much like Raven. He often found a sense of peace, just from the mesmerizing beauty in her amber eyes. It was like Raven had left a piece of herself buried deep inside her little sister, and she was growing up to look just like Raven. In the eyes of the law, and by the decree of the adoption papers, Ethic was Morgan's father, but he was truly her big brother. He could never, and had never tried, to take the place of Benny Atkins, but he would take care of Morgan with unconditional love as long as air filled his lungs. She had made it a challenge every step of the way, however, and today was one of those days. Where's Morgan? He asked Bella, who came racing down the stairs. She's not in her room, Bella shrugged. Where's Lily? Ethic asked, referring to his nanny. The elderly black woman had been a godsend to him, helping to take care of his children and keep his home intact for years after Raven had died. He'd allowed Morgan to skip their monthly cemetery visit because he knew visiting would upset her. He hadn't expected her to be gone upon his return. She must have gone home for the night. She's not here either, Bella responded. Relax, Dolce said. Morgan's 17. She'll be a grown woman soon. You can't keep the leash so tight. Lily doesn't need to keep an eye on Morgan. You have to start trusting her to make some decisions for herself. She'll only try harder to pull away from you if you don't. I'm sure she's fine. You put Easy down. I'll start dinner. Dolce took the bag from Ethic's hand, but her words did little to soothe him. He ascended the stairs to the castle he called home. The 7,000 square feet of luxury were more for the children than for him. He had spared no expense in getting it built from the ground up. He purchased it to give them a foundation and to remind him that all his ill deeds in the street had been for something. He wanted Bella, Easy, and Morgan to be protected behind these walls, but Morgan seemed adamant on playing outside the safety net he had provided. No matter how much he gave her or how far he moved them away from the hood, she always found her way back. It was like the streets called her. As he opened the door to her room, his jaw flexed in impatience as he smelled the remnants of marijuana in the air. He laid his son down on the soft duvet and then pulled his phone from his pocket. Be home in half an hour, Mo. If you're not here, I'm putting word out to have you brought home. It'll be much less embarrassing if you head home on your own. Ethic pressed send. Swiped his face in exasperation as he blew out a sharp breath. He didn't want to be that guy. It disappointed him that he had to resort to such strict tactics to get through to Morgan, but the only way to keep Morgan safe was to keep her removed. He had seen firsthand how the streets of Flint could swallow a girl whole. It had happened with Raven. He couldn't sit back and let the same thing happen to Morgan. If he had to be uncool in her eyes, so be it. He knew his ways were overprotective, but it was a byproduct of losing Raven. Was it a result of losing his mother? Or was it a reaction to losing it, period? Did he hold on too tightly out of fear of losing the women he cared for? Ethic didn't know, but at that moment he didn't care. He lacked patience when it came to her safety, and there was no leniency when it came to that. He just wanted Morgan home, and if she didn't walk through the door in the next half hour, Ethic had no qualms about sending word to the block to retrieve her. And there's a break in the chapter. Listen, let me tell you something. You better get you a number 12 cast iron skillet and Ethic and ring her goddamn bell. Listen, she may not be able to hear you when you, when you fussing at her ass, but you ring her fucking bell with that cast iron skillet. She'll feel what the fuck you mean, you heard me? I am going to hell telling him to ring a deaf girl's bell. Lord. Okay, wait. Oh my God. And y'all ain't shit because y'all sitting here laughing in y'all spaces while I'm talking crazy about this girl. Anyway, the smoke from the Kush filled blunt danced in the air as Morgan grooved to the vibrations of the speakers that sat behind her. The fact that she couldn't hear the music made her love to dance even more. Other girls danced to the beat in a predictable way, trying too hard to be cute, swaying to the music more for attention than enjoyment. Morgan was completely different. The way her hips rode the beat was awkwardly beautiful but natural. Even though she didn't seek attention, it came to her effortlessly. She bopped to the beat of her own drum, using the heavy bass that vibrated her chest as her guide, while snapping her fingers between the rotations of the blunt that was being passed around. She closed her eyes as the pulsations from the music traveled up her spine. She was in a vibe. She may not be able to hear the music, but she could feel it. She was standing in a circle full of pretty faces, but she was the only one that shined. Her bohemian chic box braids hung down her back, and the tiny diamond stud in her nose complemented her well. The red scarf she tied Tupac style around her head put some grip behind her baby face. She tried to draw on her maturity with expensive cosmetics, accentuating her pouty lips with red lipstick. She was Benjamin Atkins's youngest daughter, and although her father had died years ago, his legacy lived on. Because of it, Morgan was royalty. She couldn't help but feel like she was princess by default. None of this shit is for me. This is hers. This love is just a residual from Raven. They don't even really know who I am, Morgan thought. She felt her best friend, Niche, tap her on the shoulder as she held up a plastic soda bottle filled with purple liquid. Morgan focused on her lips. You on this? She asked. Morgan had gotten used to reading lips. She could spy on an entire conversation from across the room just by paying attention. The things that other people missed, Morgan usually picked up on. Her perception was keener because it had to be. She took the bottle and passed Niche the blunt before lifting it to her lips. She didn't even get to taste the concoction before the bottle was taken from her grasp. She lowered her head angrily, her eyes shooting daggers until they fell on his. Let's go, Shorty Duwop, he said. Oh my God, Yana. As a youngin', Shorty Duwop, listen. Oh my God. Messiah stood in front of her, face cross in irritation. His icy demeanor made his smooth, dark skin even more attractive. She loved the way his lips curved when he called her that, when he called every pretty girl that. She had seen him refer to countless girls with that nickname. It seemed to be his nickname for the beautiful ones. She was just glad she made the cut. It was moments like these Morgan wished she had the confidence to use her voice. She hadn't tried to speak since she was 5 years old. She still remembered the flush of embarrassment that filled her when her kindergarten classmates had laughed at the way her voice sounded. She hadn't spoken since that day. Hundreds of thousands of dollars had been poured into surgeries and therapy to help restore her hearing. First, her father, and then Ethic had poured money into different innovative technology over the years. They had done all they could to help her, but the fact that she couldn't hear herself made her afraid to allow anyone else to hear her speak as well. She didn't want her words to come out jumbled or awkward, and she didn't want her tone to sound weird or to highlight her handicap. So instead of saying something flirty to this god of a man in front of her, she rolled her eyes and smirked. She snatched the bottle back and he pointed a stern finger to her face. Don't play with me, he said. All I want to do is play with you, she thought. She handed over the bottle and threw up two fingers to her friends as Messiah led the way out of the park. She knew Ethic had sent him. He had a way of tracking her down that made her feel like she wore a leash. She just wanted to live her own life, and she didn't care if she fucked it up, as long as she had the freedom to make her own choices. She desperately wanted to fly free. You gonna make a nigga have to body something out here, Messiah said. Got your stomach and shit all out? Why the fuck your shorts so small, man? You ain't gotta carry it like that. That face is enough to get you all that attention you're begging for. So, he does think I'm pretty, she thought. Morgan didn't miss the insult that accompanied the compliment, but she would accept anything if it was coming from him. If he was passing out baby daddy passes and food stamp cards, I'd be first in line. That thought made her laugh aloud. Now I'm funny, huh? Got me up in here pulling you out of clubs and shit. How'd you get in anyway with your young ass? Messiah said, a small smirk playing at the side of his lips. He was too stubborn to reveal a full smile, but the way his mouth tugged upward at one corner was the sexiest thing Morgan had ever seen. She shrugged, knowing he didn't know sign language, so there was no need for her to try to respond. Get in, he said. Messiah was up and coming. After his partner had been murdered in cold blood, Messiah had stepped into a position of power, taking over a cocaine operation that ran half the city. Not only was he moving weight, but he wasn't afraid to lift anything of value that came into town. He often sought guidance from Ethic. She would catch him at Ethic's body shop, sitting for hours as they read the Wall Street Journal, and Ethic taught Messiah about stocks and bonds. She'd seen him around town with different women, but none of them seemed to stick around long. She was just waiting to turn 18 so that she could shoot her shot. He could have his pick of any woman in the city. He's not checking for me, she thought. Pretty girl, he said, as he snapped his fingers to jolt her out of her reverie. Quit daydreaming and get in. I gotta shoot you all the way out to Grand Blanc before I go handle this business, he said. She nodded as he opened the door for her, and she stumbled into the car. She knew if she walked into Ethic's house drunk and high, he would overreact, and she sighed at the thought of the argument that was to come. He thinks he's my father, Morgan thought. When Messiah slid into the driver's seat, she turned toward him. Can you at least give me a few hours to sober up, she signed. She could see the confusion on his face, but he was too polite to ask her what she was trying to say. She grabbed his phone from the cup holder of the Range Rover and called herself so that his number would pop up on her screen. She denied the call and then opened a text message. If I walk in the house like this, Ethic will kill me. Can we go somewhere for like an hour so I can sober up? He read the text and sighed before swiping a hand over his full beard. He said, as he put the car in drive and maneuvered his way through the crowded parking lot. Morgan rolled down her window. She didn't mind all the gawking women looking at her in shock as she rode shotgun next to Messiah. All his groupies were present, and she knew leaving the club with him would cause nothing but speculation. I'm not a catch, Shorty. You brag about the good boys. I'm the type you keep a secret, he said honestly. If you only knew, Morgan thought as she bit her bottom lip. She felt privileged just to have her hips spreading in those buttery leather seats. They rode through the city, and Morgan wondered if Messiah was as comfortable in the silence as she was. Silence was all that existed for her, but she hoped it wasn't awkward for him. They pulled up to Stepping Stone Falls, and a knot formed in her stomach. She hadn't been to the nature reserve since her father had been killed. She used to love to see the water cascade down the waterfalls as she sat on her father's shoulders. It was our thing, she thought sadly, as she closed her eyes. I used to be able to see his face. I can barely remember his smile anymore. She had gone somber, and now she just wanted to go home. The interior lights came on, and she watched Messiah exit the car. He dipped his head down and said, I'll be right back. Stay in the car. She looked in the side mirror and noticed another car pulling up behind them. Her eyes were glued to that mirror as she watched Messiah greet another man. She knew the deal and tore her eyes from the scene because his business was his business. She respected his privacy. When he got back in the car, he tossed a black duffel bag in her lap. Count up for me? He asked. She nodded and unzipped the bag to see that it was full of different denominations of bills inside. She focused in as she organized and counted the money. 50 bands, she signed. He was lost and she smiled, picking up her phone to text the message to him. He looked at his phone and then mimicked her hand movement. This is how you say 50,000? He asked. She nodded. How did you lose your hearing? He asked. You ain't got an answer, but I always wondered. He always wondered? Does that mean he thinks about me? She thought. I was born deaf. My sister was born perfect, and I was born like this. I used to hate it. Now I'm kind of grateful that I can drown out the noise. The world is filled with too much bullshit. He read the text and nodded. Real shit. Sometimes I wish I could block out the world, too. That's what Ethic is trying to do. Keep the bad shit from you. Why are you out here chasing trouble? Your trouble, she signed. He mimicked her body language, moving his hands in the same way. Trouble, she mouthed. Yeah, I'm trouble, he confirmed. She was addicted to the way his full lips moved when he spoke. She felt her body react as a pulse started in her panties and traveled through her body, making her shudder. I don't think so, she signed. He shook his head as he gave a rare smile, understanding that. He quickly corrected himself and the smile disappeared. She had already witnessed it, though, committing it to memory instantly. Morgan pointed out the window toward the falls and then popped open the door before he could protest. She stood in front of his car, headlights shining around her as she bent her finger, beckoning him to come to her. The fact that he didn't come right away made her want him more. He wasn't a puppet to anyone. He didn't follow orders. He gave them, and he made her wait as he contemplated whether he wanted to join her or not. She held her hands up in a pleading motion and pouted. He didn't budge, so she removed her shirt and dropped it on the ground as she stepped out of the light into the darkness that covered the rest of the reserve. Morgan shed a piece of clothing with every few steps she took, leaving a trail for him to find her when he finally decided to join her. She stepped into the water, gasping at how cold it was this time of year. She eased into the water, her nipples hardening under the fabric of her bra as she shivered. It was exhilarating, the bite of the cold water against her skin. It made her feel alive. The reflection of the moon shone over the water, and Morgan got lost in the beauty of the night. When she turned back to shore, she was waist deep. She saw Messiah standing on the beach, holding her clothes in his hands. His arms were outstretched in perplexity. She was glad she couldn't hear, because if she could, she knew he would be calling for her to come back. He'd be trying to talk some sense into her, and she just wanted to blow free like the wish weeds she used to pull when she was a kid. She turned her back to him and stared at the moon, transfixed, until she felt the ripples of the water change patterns, letting her know someone else had gotten in. "You're crazy as shit," Messiah said. She saw his lips moving, but there was too much space between them, and his skin mixed with the dark night made it impossible for her to tell what was spoken. She moved closer to him. He tensed. His shoulder-length dreads were pulled back off his face as he stared down at her. "It's time I take you home." She shook her head. She reached out to touch his face, but he caught her wrist. Her heart raced just from the fact that he was touching her. She took his hand and placed it on her chest. Her weighted breaths caused her chest to heave. She wanted him to feel her heartbeat. He looked at her, drawn into her uniqueness, into her freeness. She was like a fire, silent in her destruction and uncontainable. Messiah was walking a fine line. Ethic was a man he respected, and he didn't want conflict, yet still he couldn't pull away. Lord have mercy. She reached out and put her hand on his tattoo-covered chest. He was like a mural of ink, and she secretly wondered what each one meant. He kept his cool, and his face was unmoved, but he couldn't hide the beat she felt through his strong chest. She closed the little space that remained between them and hopped up around his waist. Her legs circled his back, and her arms went behind his neck as he held her up with one arm around her back. "We gotta go," he whispered. His strong body was tense, cautious. He pulled her hand as he began to step toward the shore. She pulled back. Almost instantly, his strong arm was around her waist, pulling her to him. She shook her head, declining his request to leave. He closed his eyes and rested his forehead against hers before pulling away abruptly. Just like that, their connection was broken. She sighed as she followed him toward dry land. He bent down to put on his clothes and then turned away to give her some privacy as she stepped into her own. He had to get out of her proximity before something happened that he would regret. Morgan was a beautiful girl, but she was young, jailbait, and at 17, she wasn't ready for what he offered at 25. He was in the streets heavy, with no intentions of slowing down. Messing with Morgan would be a direct violation of ethics. He was lucky to have ethics counsel at all. Messiah didn't want to burn that bridge, not over pussy, no matter how pretty it was. Men wanted to conquer Morgan simply because of who she was, and he didn't want that. He didn't want to prey on her for her namesake. It just couldn't happen between them. He wasn't into young girls. His conscience and who he was as a man wouldn't allow it. Morgan walked past him, filled with embarrassment and feeling foolish that he had turned her down. She climbed inside the car and turned towards the window as he entered as well. This time, the silence was loud as they avoided conversation the entire way. Morgan couldn't get out of the car fast enough. As soon as Messiah pulled into the driveway, Morgan bolted from the car, slamming the door so hard that Messiah cringed. He climbed out the car and followed her into the house. By the time he caught up to her, Epic had her frozen in sight. Morgan was in tears and Messiah's stomach twisted, knowing that she was crying because of his rejection. "Are you hurt?" Ethic asked. She shook her head. "Are you high?" Ethic grilled. Normally, when Ethic asked a question, he already knew the answer, so Morgan knew better than to lie. Under his intense stare, Morgan shrank. She didn't want to lie to him, so she opted for silence, looking off to the side as her eyes watered. It was in these moments when Ethic reminded her so much of her father that she felt the saddest. He shouldn't have to discipline her. She should have parents for that. But her father had been gunned down by the police years ago on a Sunday morning. On the day that belonged to the Lord, the devil had come and snatched the foundation of her family away. She remembered it like it was yesterday, and it still hurt. Now, Ethic was left playing the paternal role. Although she loved him, it wasn't the same. Morgan could see the disappointment in Ethic's eyes. And for a moment, it felt like she was sitting in front of the late, great Benjamin Atkins himself. Ethic was cut from the same cloth as her late father. "Go upstairs, Morgan. Sleep it off. We'll talk about everything in the morning," Ethic said. Morgan nodded and then retreated up the stairs. Messiah wanted her to look back at him just so he could look in her eyes one more time, but she didn't. I appreciate you going to get a home, he ethics said as he pulled out a knot of $100 bills. Come on now, put that up. We don't count favors. Anytime, OG. It's nothing, Messiah said. He slapped hands and embraced Ethic before breaking out. He didn't want to leave things as they were, but it really wasn't his place to fix Morgan. She had been broken way before Messiah came along, so he would let sleeping dogs lie. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. He done built a house in a upscale gated community for her. But I'm guessing it never once dawned on him to get the poor thing some therapy. I guess. I don't know, child. Listen. I'm gonna mind my business and read, okay? So what are y'all thinking? Y'all liking this so far? Y'all better say y'all like this because y'all beg for this shit. Okay? So I don't want to hear nothing about it. I'm going to be as deaf as Morgan when it comes to this. Chapter 2. She's just trying to spread her wings a little bit. She'll be okay. The sound of Dolce voicing her opinion on things that didn't involve her irritated him. She came up behind him, wrapping her arms around him as if she was his peace of mind. She wasn't that for him. That wasn't her place in his life. And the more she tried to force it, the more it turned him off. He removed her hands and turned to her. It's getting late. I could stay. Not tonight, all right? I'll get up with you. not I'll get up with you. The ultimate rejection. Like, I just want to be alone tonight. What the fuck? Okay. Obligation made him lift her chin and kiss her cheek. He could practically see her deflate from his refusal. He wasn't trying to hurt her feelings. That wasn't his intention, but giving her more than casual sex wasn't an option, and tonight he wasn't even beat for that. He was a man conflicted, scarred, burned by the emotion he couldn't seem to get a grip on. To a man that was used to being in control, his current state made him feel weak. I gotta get my mind right, he thought. Dolce's eyes were pleading with him, a body language begging him to take out his angst within the heaven between her legs. Women were equipped with superpowers in that way. Within their opening lied bliss, and Dolce was offering it to him without uttering a word. He had never missed a sign from a woman, and Dolce was giving him the green light to fuck his problems away. A lesser man would have taken her up on the offer, but Ethic just wanted to breathe. He walked over to the door and held it open as she walked out. Damn! He just opened the door. Take you and your good to your vehicle and head up out of town, bitch. Not tonight, playgirl. She turned sharply, huffing in angst, as she pointed a warning finger in his face. One day, you're going to look up and I'm going to be gone. I know, he replied simply. He closed the door. I'm cold-blooded. I done wrote his ass saying, could that be tomorrow? Could tomorrow be one day, ma'am? Okay. Oh, so he closed the door. The weight of the world was too heavy for one man to carry. He thought about the things he had done, the lives he'd taken, the poison he had pumped into the veins of his community, and he couldn't help but think this loneliness was his karma. He believed that God made man and woman in pairs. The reward for a good life lived was to meet that soul that was intended to be your mate. The consequence for a life squandered was what he was living through now. To find an amazing woman, not once, not even twice, but three times, and to lose them all was nothing short of punishment. Ethic had struck out. And now he had to navigate through parenting a teenage girl and his own two children alone. He wanted to go upstairs and talk to Morgan about her behavior, perhaps punish her for being reckless, but he didn't know how. She reminded him so much of Raven that it hurt to watch her grow. It angered him that she was slipping down the same slippery slope that had destroyed her sister. His head wasn't right at the moment. I'll address it tomorrow, he thought, when I cool down. He peeked in on his sleeping young ones and stood outside Morgan's room. He grabbed the handle on her door but halted, knowing that space was needed tonight for them both. She can be mad all she wants as long as she's home and she's safe, he thought. He had won the small battle. He would handle the war in the morning. He descended the steps to his home until he reached the lowest level of his three-story home. It was where he went when he needed to remove himself. when he wanted to unplug from being a father, a gangster, a mentor, when he just wanted to be human, when he wanted to be the man that he would have been had the streets not made him a beast, he went down there. It was his sanctuary, and no one else was allowed to disturb the energy in that space. He pulled off his shirt, his temple of a body looking like nothing less than a work of art. Each tattoo on his dark skin symbolized significance in his life and told the story of a boy who had navigated his way to manhood alone. He was life's exhibit of survival, the epitome of what this world did to Black boys, turning them into men too soon and then getting upset when these men, who didn't know themselves, lacked maturity. Grown men who were still boys inside broke things because they themselves were broken. Rules, hearts, men like Ethan were just prone to breaking shit, but they had no idea how to repair themselves when the shoe was on the other foot. He pulled out the gym mat, stepped out of his pants before reaching into a drawer and removing a pair of Nike athletic tights. The fabric fit his muscular legs like a second pair of skin. He remained shirtless and then removed his socks before stepping up to the mat. Meditation was the thing that stopped him from pulling triggers. It had taken him years to figure out that his gun was only to be used when every other alternative had been exhausted. He would lay a nigga to rest should the need occur. He was made up 100% G, and at times gunplay was necessary, but only self-control could help him make the decision. Yoga and meditation taught him to always have complete autonomy over his mind. Love had fucked that all up because no matter how hard he tried, he couldn't stop the pain he felt. Love had made him susceptible to weakness. He had to get a handle on that shit. He reached over his head, making a temple with his fingers as he looked toward the ceiling. Every muscle on his exposed chest flexed as he began his routine. His strong core held him up as he moved fluidly through difficult poses as he cleared his mind and pushed his body to the limit. Sweat glistened on his dark skin as he controlled his breathing. His stamina was endless. He went through his hour-long ritual with ease, ending on the floor with his eyes closed and legs crossed, breathing deeply. His blood pumped wildly, reminding him that he was alive. The pain told him he was alive and that this feeling he had was a part of living, a part of being privileged to be 6 feet above ground. As he stood and grabbed a towel to wipe away his sweat, he told himself if he couldn't shake the feeling, he would learn from it and make sure that he never felt it again. As he cut out the lights and ascended the stairs, he shut off his heart. Epic flipped the switch that allowed him to love, allowed him to hurt, allowed him to live. He went back into his shell, promising himself that he wouldn't expose himself again. And there's a break in the chapter. Child, listen. Hey, Marva. Happy Thursday, darling. Welcome. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. I wonder what happened to the little baby that asked me, Okay, hold on. Let me see. We've been out here 47 minutes. The notifications must not be notification today. Let me see. Either that or, child, something else is going on. You know how y'all do. Y'all like the mess, so y'all be over there, wherever there is. All right. Sitting at the window seat, staring out over the sprawling green lawn, Morgan felt like Rapunzel, trapped in a tower and dying to be free. Nobody understood her. How could they? No one knew what it was like to walk through a world without fully experiencing it. They had no idea how loud things got inside her head. Morgan hated that she wanted to be accepted by the same people she despised. She hated them for the superficiality, hated them for being so normal, and for not appreciating the blessing that came with being able. Able to hear, able to just exist without people feeling awkward around them. She always felt like she was under a microscope. Curious eyes gawked in surprise, wondering how she could be so beautiful yet be so flawed. People always stared. So Morgan put on a show, acting out, frustrated with people and their judgments. Nobody understood her, not even Ethic. And although he tried his best to make her feel loved, she simply felt like she didn't belong. She wasn't his daughter. Her family was gone, and she didn't quite fit in anyone else's life. Nobody accepted her like her family had. When they were alive, she barely even realized she was different than anyone around her. They made her feel secure, but as soon as they went in the grave, all her insecurities surfaced. See, this is the problem with the young mind, because, okay, your family is gone, but this man is treating you like his own child. Appreciate that, love that, ingratiate yourself into that, immerse yourself in it, girl. Because listen, your ass could be a fuck of war to the state and out here getting fucked on and fucked over in a foster home, child. Because, no, God, it's just the ungratefulness for me. That's the problem. It's being an ungrateful little heifer. She picked up the phone and looked at Messiah's number. She stored it in her contacts before tossing the phone to the bed. She wished she could call him. If she had a voice, she would. She desperately wanted to belong to someone, not out of obligation the way ethic had inherited her, but out of need. The way a man wanted a woman to be only his. She wanted someone, anyone, to choose her and to love her, flaws and all. Until she found it, she would drown the loneliness in liquor and weed to distract herself from the things she couldn't have. Just stupid. The rays of the sun broke through the curtains, disrupting Morgan's restless sleep. It blazed through her closed lids, illuminating her mind and forcing her to open her eyes. She dreaded the discussion that was to come. The parenting. She never really took to the idea of anyone disciplining her, because that was the job of the people who made her. Ethic had not. Therefore, his concern seemed manufactured. He's just going through the motions. Nobody gives a fuck about a kid that doesn't belong to them, she thought. She was just waiting for her 18th birthday to come around. She had already graduated high school. She would break out and never look back, even if she had to leave with just the clothes on her back. Morgan was itching to live life by her own rules. Until she get out there and get fucked up, you heard me? She climbed out of bed and sauntered downstairs. Smeared mascara and remnants of last night's ruby woo still stained her face. Mo money. Oh, I guess she calls her Mo Money. Okay, it's on two different pages. I'm sorry. Mo Money, Bella signed, calling Morgan by the nickname that she had since they were kids. Morgan smiled. She had a special place in her heart for Bella. She took a seat at the dining room table and took a fork to Bella's plate. Is this my shirt, Bella? Morgan signed. Ethic had made sure everyone living under their roof had learned sign language so that they could communicate with one another. The fact that a 12-year-old can fit it means you shouldn't have it on, Ethic interrupted. He didn't sign because he knew Morgan was zeroed in on him, anticipating his parental wrath. Ha ha, Morgan signed. So, what's my punishment for last night? Ethic's face was serious. He was always so stern, as if he was in a constant state of deep contemplation. She was prepared for him to lock her in her room forever. But to her surprise, he said, let's wash it. I? Now, I haven't been as focused on you or them like I should, so I'm partly to blame. I need you to move smarter, though. I don't want you in the city, you hear me? I need you to understand who you are. He made it sound like she was a porcelain doll that would break if handled too much. And she wasn't looking for a fight, however, so she simply nodded. I'm lucky he didn't take my car, she thought. Oh, shit, my car, she remembered, realizing she had left it in the parking lot of the club. She didn't want to bring it up. She didn't need to give Ethic any more incentive to reprimand her. Your birthday is coming up, Ethic said. You're not canceling my party, Morgan signed. Of course not, Ethic replied. Your father threw you a party every year. I still remember when I met you and Raven at your 6th birthday celebration. You were the prettiest girl in the room. Benjamin was proud of you. He was proud of Raven. He introduced the two of you as if he had his own personal angels. I wouldn't break that tradition. I know what it means to you and what it meant to him. Morgan nodded and blinked away tears as she noticed the lights flicker in the house. Every inch of Ethic's home had been tailored to fit Morgan's handicap, including the doorbell. A twinge of guilt rushed over her as she realized how much Ethic truly had done for her over the years. He may not have been her father, but he was the closest thing she had to one. His love for her was forgiving, just like her father's had been for her sister Raven. Thank you, she signed. I'll get the door. She pulled open the door in haste and was shocked when Messiah stood in front of her. His dreads were pulled half up off his face, and the back hung shoulder length. Was that a smile, she thought, as she noticed a change in his disposition. It was so slight that she questioned if she had imagined it. His style was always so effortless. Morgan hated the guys from around the way who flaunted everything they had all at once. There was nothing gaudy about Messiah. His effortless cool drew her in. He knew he was paid. He didn't have to prove it, so he kept his style simple. Jeans, a V-neck, and a leather vest. The Rolex on his wrist was all the accessory he needed. No chains, no earrings, just Messiah and the condescending smirk that he seemed to reserve for her. She didn't know if he found her amusing or if he found her intriguing. He held up the key to her car. "Ethic here?" he asked. She moved to the side as he eased by her, brushing by her arrogantly. He had no idea what he did to her. Her youth made what she felt for him so intense. "Hold on, y'all." Okay, sorry, y'all. Y'all Speakeasy Grandma said, hey. All right. When she was around him, the air felt too thick to breathe. His cologne, Creed, she thought, hugged her as he passed. And she had to grab the doorframe. He made her knees weak without even trying, without even noticing. He's so fucking arrogant, she thought. What's up, big homie? Messiah greeted. My people took me to pick up the car and I drove it here. I didn't want to bring nobody out to your spot. I know how you are when it comes to shit like that. You think you can run me back to the crib? Morgan can drop you, Ethic said. Messiah turned to Morgan. Drop me at the crib? He asked. Morgan nodded before leading the way outside. She almost forgot that she had just rolled out of bed. She climbed into the passenger side of her car and cringed as she glanced at her reflection in the visor mirror. As Messiah walked around to the driver's side, she hurriedly licked her fingers to try to slick down the edges of her hair and then wiped her eyes with the sleeve of her shirt to remove the day-old cosmetics that now resembled clown makeup. She was sure her breath smelled like corn chips. At least it tasted like it. And she sighed in frustration. He had to pull up on me looking this good and smelling this good. Meanwhile, I'm sitting here looking crazy, she thought, mortified. Don't you hate it when they be looking all luscious and lickety and you be looking like, who shot John? Oh, Lord have mercy. When he lowered into the seat, she snapped the sun visor shut. Young girls worried about the most trivial things, and Morgan was no different. She was damn near holding up breath to make sure he didn't smell her funk. She wondered what he was thinking behind his brooding stare. He didn't speak, so neither did she. Even though she desperately wanted to rehash the events that had happened the night before, he had paid her more attention than she had ever seen him pay anyone. He had opened up to her. She had felt it. Or am I tripping? He's sitting here like I don't even exist. It didn't help that he couldn't sign and she couldn't speak. It was like the sun had come up and exposed all the reasons why she could never have him. Did she have her phone? I don't know. She's 17 now, Marva. Yeah, she's 17. So, yeah. And she's like a Messiah. All right. She desperately wanted to go back to the dark where it was safe to let her inhibitions go. In the dark, it had felt possible that Messiah would want a girl like her. The silence was killing her, but she refused to beg him for his attention. She didn't want to seem pressed, so she settled into her seat and watched block after block pass them by. With every mile they drove, she felt the opportunity to be in his space dwindling. When they pulled up to a modest two-story home on the north side, she noticed a girl waiting patiently for him as she leaned against his car. Morgan turned up her nose as jealousy seared her. The girl's beauty was typical, fat ass, slim waist, long weave, so on trend. There was nothing original about her. Oh, Build-A-Bear ass bitch, Morgan thought, as she... Now Morgan a whole hater and she done called that lady a Build-A-Bear ass bitch. Now Morgan, come on now. That ain't right, girl. That is not right. Oh, Lord have mercy. Anyway. Morgan thought as she rolled her eyes, making no attempt to fix her face. Morgan knew she was Hayden. The girl was exactly the type that she would have expected Messiah to be attracted to. He probably had a collection of women that he alternated each day of the week. Morgan wanted to be the one he called on Sunday. His family, the one who dragged him to church to balance his sins and then fucked him on the same table they ate Sunday dinner on. A man gave his Sunday to the woman he loved. That's why this thirst bucket is here on a Wednesday. Oh, hump day ass bitch. Appreciate you. Lord have mercy, Jesus. Lord have mercy, I'm hot. Okay, she chuckled at that. I did too, bitch, with my hating ass. Damn, why couldn't God give me an ass like that? Messiah put the car in park and then climbed out. Morgan followed suit as the bobblehead girl with the weave bounced over to the car. Hey, babe, she cooed. Morgan almost gagged. She was so sick. She knew the girl was putting on stake and claim as she wrapped her arms around Messiah's neck and planted a deep kiss on his lips. He pulled back, slightly, not one for public affection. He rubbed his lips with his thumb before licking his lips. He turned to Morgan. Morgan, this is Shayna. Shayna, this is Morgan. Morgan waved, and the girl returned with a dry, hey, thanks for the drop-off, Messiah said. Thank you for getting my car, she signed. Car? Messiah asked, as he mimicked her signs. She nodded with a meek smile. She noticed she always had his full attention when she signed. She appreciated the effort he put into understanding her. Aw, she's deaf, right? That's Benny Atkins's daughter. I used to know her sister. Well, not know her, but I used to see her around. Everybody used to want to be like Raven Atkins back in the day, the girl said, reminiscent. Morgan was over this girl. She had just confirmed her groupie status. She was a hanger-on, and Morgan had no interest in entertaining the conversation further. Morgan frowned and lifted her hand as she looked at Messiah as if to say, who is this bitch? His smirk returned. Give me a minute. I'll meet you inside, Messiah said as he passed the girl his keys. When she disappeared inside, he turned to Morgan. I'll see you around, he said. No more hole-in-the-wall club, shorty. That ain't for you. She nodded as she headed back to her car. She was livid that she was the one he was seeing off. Meanwhile, a lesser woman was waiting for him inside his home. Knowing that Messiah was off limits to her, she got into her car without looking back before pulling away. Child, listen, and there's a little break in the chapter. Hey, Choco Chip. Happy Thursday, darling. Welcome. Thank you for being here and for bringing the good vibes with you. All right. Okay. Morgan Atkins was a princess, throne, crown, the whole nine yards. Her 18th birthday celebration proved exactly how much love her family had around town. Ethic had spared no expense, renting out a mansion on the outskirts of town. He'd given her a real-life castle for the day. Morgan did nothing ordinary. Her event was like a local Met Gala, with formal attire required and all. Waiters walked around with hors d'oeuvres and champagne for the guests who were of age. A full spread was available in the kitchen. Lobster and crab, specially prepared by a five-star chef, had been flown in from Maine. The all-white ballroom theme was something out of a fairy tale, and Morgan looked like royalty. Her escada gown was ripped straight off a runway. Short and sexy, a sheer overlay dragged behind her when she walked. Her braids, along with the gold beads with henna tattoos, gave her a unique style that only she could pull off. Her winged eyeliner gave her a Cleopatra, Nefertiti, or some other Black Queen vibe. She was their equal because Morgan was just an effortlessly gorgeous human being. Morgan was one of the pretty people, just as her sister had been, just as their mother had been. She came from a long line of inherited beauty. "This is crazy," Nish said as she posed for the cameraman that kept the bulbs flashing as Morgan's guests walked the red carpet and took pictures in front of a step and repeat. Morgan and Nish posed for over an hour before moving inside where a huge crowd was congregated in the great room. Morgan looked around in amazement. Ethic hugged the corner of the room, clad in a simple black Tom Ford suit with Dolce gleefully on his arm. "Why he keep dipping back to this motherfucking, I almost said something real fucking ignorant. Trash. Anyway. Anyone who was anyone and lived on the north side was present from Morgan's age to Ethics. It was a turnout of epic proportions. The city's biggest DJ kept the atmosphere jovial. Morgan was delighted. Ethic had pulled off a celebration for her every year to honor the tradition that her father had started. But this year, he had outdone himself. She felt slightly guilty for giving him a hard time. Morgan knew that her growing pains caused him great concern, but she just wanted to live life fully without the childish rules Ethic smothered her with. She smiled as guests greeted her, but when he walked through the door, her face fell in disappointment. She had been silently searching the crowd, discreetly looking for him, hoping to drift through a waft of his cologne, but she hadn't seen him. Now that her eyes were on him, she wished he would just leave. "He brought that tacky beauty supply weave-buying-ass bitch to my party," she thought. Uh-oh, not the old hump day-ass bitch. Not the Build-A-Bear-ass bitches at the party. No, God. Lord have mercy. She felt like a brat as she balled her fists at her sides. Morgan could have thrown a tantrum on the spot, but instead she took a deep breath to calm the sick feeling that was invading her stomach as they approached. "There go your boy," Nish signed. "His girlfriend is cute. Cheap dress, but she's straight." Morgan and Nish went back to elementary school. While other girls used secret codes like Pig Latin, Nish and Morgan talked shit using sign language. They were their own little club and had remained close throughout the years. Morgan had taught maybe a little bit, yes. Sorry. Morgan had taught Nish how to sign over the years. At that moment, she wished she hadn't taught her at all. Morgan was jealous enough without Nish rubbing it in. Morgan rolled her eyes and turned to face Messiah as he came strolling in. She took him in. The navy suit he wore was so dark it almost looked black, and it was tailored to perfection, with red bottom studded loafers to accent it. The Versace shirt he wore underneath was trendy, and he wore extravagant jewelry, 6 diamond chains and 4 diamond rings on his left hand. He wore his dreads, French braided in 2 to the back, and a gold presidential on his wrist. He was intoxicating, and his cologne made matters even worse. Thank you. Messiah was a young man, getting money, and he always looked the part of a young boss. His normal understated style was put away for the occasion. He didn't care if he looked like new money. All spent the same. He carried a small box that had been beautifully wrapped and handed it to Morgan. "Happy birthday, beautiful," he greeted. Morgan took the gift and gave him a short smile. At least he showed up. He could have skipped it altogether, she thought. "Thank you," she signed. Ethic walked up and greeted Messiah. "Your young gunners outside?" Ethic asked, getting straight to business. Just because there was a reason to celebrate didn't mean he would drop his guard. Ethic would never put himself in a position to be caught slipping. He had to make sure the party was safe and that every guest who walked through the door was weapon-free. Every guest except himself and Messiah, that is. "Yeah, my niggas on it. We good," Messiah concurred. He slapped hands with Ed, who then eased back into his corner, allowing the flow of the party to resume. "I'ma see you before I leave out of here, I hope you like the gift," Messiah said. Morgan nodded as she watched him walk away with another girl on his arm. She didn't feel much like partying after that, but she put on a smile as the night thrived and everyone had a good time. Morgan couldn't quite fix her mood. Not with Messiah sitting across the room with his date in his lap. They were whispering, and the girl smiled as if Messiah was telling her the best joke in the world. Nigga ain't even funny. Goofy bitch just being extra, Morgan thought. She hated that Messiah had reduced her to a hater. Truth was, Shayna was gorgeous, and Morgan knew it. She had that grown woman feel that made Morgan feel as if she was simply a little girl with a school-age crush. She dug into her purse and retrieved her cell phone as she stormed away from the crowd. She was sick, literally. She felt like she would throw up. Messiah was too close to her to be so distant, and she hated the fact that someone else was making him look good. One second, y'all. All right, Morgan retreated to the restroom and she locked the door as she exhaled. She clicked on Messiah's number, her fingers stabbing the screen of her phone as she sent him a text. Why are you ignoring me? I'm not ignoring you, Shorty. I see you clearly. You act like the night at the lake didn't happen, like you didn't feel it. It's not the time or place for this conversation. Where are you? Just come out and enjoy your party. People are looking for you. How am I supposed to enjoy anything with that bitch sailing all in your face? I hate that she's here with you. I hate her, period. Hate is a strong word, Shorty, LOL. You should save it for more appropriate things like broccoli. Morgan smiled at that and shook her head. I felt something that night, Messiah, something real. Just drop it. We both know the rules. You're young, and I know what you think you feel, but Morgan clasped the phone as she waited for Messiah to finish his text. He was brushing her off, dismissing their chemistry as if she was too childish to distinguish real from fake. Morgan's pride was injured. I can't, Mo. Off principle. It ain't right. I'm out. I hope you enjoy the rest of your day. Didn't mean to ruin the vibe. Morgan rushed out of the restroom. She wanted to stop him from leaving, knowing that she didn't really want him to go, but by the time she emerged from her hiding spot, he was already out the door. Ethic watched Morgan from afar, amazed at how quickly the years had passed. When he had first gotten custody of her, she was just a little girl. He had tried his hardest to replace the family she had lost, and although it was a cheap substitute, he hoped Morgan knew that he loved her like she was his very own. She had blossomed into a beautiful young woman, and he knew that he intended to hold on too tightly, but it was out of fear. He knew that all that glittered wasn't gold. He didn't want to learn or didn't want her to learn that lesson the hard way. So he was overprotective, not just with Morgan, but with Bella and Easy as well. They were his world, and he would do anything to keep them out of harm's way. You've done her father a real service, Ethic, Dolce whispered in his ear. Not many men would have stepped up to take care of her the way you have. You should be proud. I just worry. I see a lot of her sister in her. She wants to move too fast, and I'm trying to get her to pump the brakes, Ethic admitted. She's not her sister, Dolce reminded him. I wish she would shut the fuck up. Anyway, and if you would let go of the past, maybe you could move forward and appreciate a good woman that's right in front of you. Dolce's voice was laced in resentment. He had wounded her. She had been in the picture before he had ever loved Raven, and he had cast her aside to love other women over the years. Well, that means she just stupid, dumb, a hanger-on, thirst bucket. And she called you ugly, nigga. Don't forget, she called your crunchy face ass ugly. And you over here worrying about her feelings. Fuck her feelings. She called you ugly. Ugly ass nigga is what she said. So it was the double. Because isn't she Hispanic? So her calling you an ugly ass nigga, that's a racial slur, sir. It's the double for me. Isn't there a bigger one? Sorry. Hurting her was never his intention. He was always honest about where they stood, but somehow she always ended up expecting more. She walked away, and he could tell by the way she threw her hips with a mission from side to side that she was filled with attitude and anger. He sighed. I gotta stop fucking with her. She can't handle friends with benefits. She says she can, but her actions always speak the opposite, he thought. Ethic knew she was waiting around, hoping to get a ring by default or even a promotion to an official title of girlfriend. But he just couldn't give that to her. That type of commitment required a connection that they just didn't share. Ethic knew it was wrong to string her along, but she was always so available to him. Even when he told her that he wasn't looking to make things serious, she still stayed. She still cooked and sucked and fucked and catered to him. She was doing it to earn a prize. Their sexual chemistry was amazing, but in every other aspect between a man and a woman, they were flat. Ethic didn't know if his standards were just too high or if Dolce was falling short, but he couldn't give her more. He wondered if he was causing her the type of pain that plagued him. It seemed to be a cycle. People loved the ones that couldn't love them back. The ways of the world were just fucked up that way. Ethic watched as the servers brought out the magnificent cake Morgan had chosen. Her taste was over the top, but he never told her no. He granted her every wish because he knew her father would have. The crowd began to sing, and Morgan blushed as she covered her face. Bashfully. The party was a success, but he couldn't wait to give her the gift he had purchased. He had watched Morgan overcompensate her entire life, but not being able to hear, she had even deferred college, refusing to take a scholarship to Michigan State because she didn't think she could keep up. He believed that she parted and filled her life with distractions to try and be as regular as those around her. She was striving for ordinary when he knew she was bred to be extraordinary. Ethic just wanted to give her every opportunity he could. He had researched the experimental treatment that would restore her hearing for years. Now that she was old enough, he would give her the choice of whether she wanted it or not. He let her enjoy her evening, sitting back in the cut, watching the door cautiously and never losing sight of Morgan. Around midnight, the crowd began to disperse, and she walked over to him with nothing but joy in her eyes. Her happiness made him happy. "Thank you so much, Ethic," she said, throwing her arms around him and giving him a huge bear hug. "You're welcome," he replied. "I'm going to hang for a bit. I'll be home before it's too late. Is that cool?" Morgan signed. She was 18 and technically grown, so Ethic knew she was only asking out of respect. This was the point in her life where she would begin to make her own decisions. He couldn't stop her from going out. "It's not too late already, huh?" he signed back. She eyed him, or side-eyed him, and pursed her lips. As he rubbed the back of his neck while shaking his head, "I'm not ready for you to be grown, man. This is crazy," he said. "I wanted to give you another present, but we can do all that when you get home. Go have fun with your friend. Be safe. Move smart," he reminded. She beamed a smile and rushed out with Niche. "You got the bag in the car?" Morgan signed. "Of course," Niche replied. "I'll drive while you change, and then we can swap. Hurry up. I'm not trying to get there too late. The line will be out the door." Morgan smirked, knowing that she had never stood in a line a day of her life, and tonight wouldn't be any different. She had enjoyed her party. It was tradition, and she didn't have the heart to tell Ethic that she had no interest in one this year. But she was ready for a real turn-up. On a Saturday night, there was only one place to be. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. All right, y'all. That's it. It's been an hour and 18 minutes. I'm going to stop right here because my sister reminded me that I got to handle up on some family business right quick. So yeah, this was short, sweet, and to the point. Okay. Now we'll finish this up tomorrow. So, and as a matter of fact, I'm gonna put the notification out there in about, it'll be out there. Let me take about 5 minutes to make the notification for tomorrow out there, because we're gonna finish this shit tomorrow. All right. It says we have about 4.5 hours left in the book. So with us shit talking and kikiing and cackling and my grandma calling and my son getting on my nerves, it's probably about 5.5 hours. But either way, I'll be ready. All right? So I know y'all about to travel the highways and byways of the YouTube verse. All right? And because I love y'all, I want y'all to make it back to the speakeasy in one piece. I caution you guys to look both ways when crossing the streets because y'all is some loose ass drivers at the wheel, okay? I appreciate y'all listening to me read out loud. I just appreciate y'all showing up. You heard me? I really do. And thank you, Love Jones, so much for being such a wonderful moderator. You are the cat's meow girl, but you already know that because I tell you every day, whether we own the live stream or not. All right, so listen, the bee's knees even, all right? Thank you so much. All right, listen, y'all have a great evening. I'm sure y'all going to be tripping the light fantastic around YouTube, and hell, I might even see y'all around there once I finish up with what I got to do. Y'all will see me dropping down in somebody's chat should they happen to go live. All right? So y'all have a great evening, and if you do nothing else, y'all say it with me. Please salute your spirit and protect your peace. Until next time, bye, y'all.